Let's do it.
2-inch schedule 80 in the 2G position today. We're going to do root pass along with some good arc shots, hot pass, and a 2-bead cap. But first, the prep. I got a sample pack of Weiler abrasives, so this is a good chance to put them to the test. Flapper wheel for the inside diameter, a flap disc for the outside. These coupons are prepped pretty well with some protective stuff on them. They came from Triangle Engineering. I'm going to put 2 bridge tacks. I have never been allowed to use bridge tacks on any job that I've been on, but I'm figuring I'll give them a shot here for the sake of this video. Bridge tacks are tacks that don't penetrate all the way to the root. I'm gapping it with 532 wire, and I have ground some flat spots on the side just so they'll twist and come out of there really easy after the tacks shrink. No land, 332 rod, 95 amps, lift arc TIG. Here we go. This is the dip keyhole method. And the key is you got to keyhole just a little bit, but not too much. And you got to keep the rod in there pretty often, and you got to push a little bit of rod each dip. You don't want to just barely dip and starve the puddle. You won't get any reinforcement on the side. But if you push a little bit in, not jam it in, if you jam it in, you'll get a cold shut of unmelted wire on the backside. So it just takes a little gentle push. When you have to stop with a scratch start or a lift arc, you don't want to just snap right out. You trail out inside the bevel, but away from the edge of the bevel so you don't melt that edge away. Okay, half of it's done and the bridge tacks are ground out with a really slight taper feathered on each end for the tie-in. I didn't get an arc shot of that. Thought I did, but I did not get it. So I'm going to weld the rest of this up here, and I'll skip forward a little bit because it's all going to look pretty much the same. Here it is again, just keyhole a little bit. Now if I had a narrower gap, like an eighth gap, I might need to go to 100 amps instead of 95. If I had a 332 gap, I might need to go even higher. I decided on 532 spacers just because I wanted to push some reinforcement through the root, and I figured that would do it. All right, for the hot pass and the rest of the passes, I'm using 110 amps. Now, because I had a few uneven places in the root, some of them were closer to flush than others, for parts of this, I'm just leaving the rod in the puddle using the lay wire technique. For other parts, I'm dipping in and out. Personally, I can generally carry a little bit more metal if I dip in and out because I can push a little bit in with each dip. So what I'm doing here is on the areas that are high, I'm just walking over the rod, and areas that are low, I'm dipping in and out to try to push a little bit so that it can be somewhat even by the time I'm finished with the hot pass. Now I am trying not to get outside of the bevel, but you can see I'm nipping it here and there. Every now and then I'll shake or slip or whatever, but I'm not getting out of scope too bad. I'm still going to have some fairly straight lines to follow for the cover pass. It's a great idea to get some left-hand practice, too. I mean, boilermakers all know this. They have to use right-hand, left-hand, and they never have much room to weld, even. So they're welding in tight quarters all the time and having to switch hands. So hats off to all the boilermaker welders out there. You can see I'm wearing one of my TIG fingers here. It makes a huge difference on something like this. This pipe is getting really smoking hot, but I'm not. I'm able to prop and stay steady and not have to worry about that part of it. Next, a 2-bead cap. Again, for parts of this, I'm kind of just leaving the rod in there. In fact, for most of it, I'm leaving the rod in there, but occasionally I'll dip like right here. And the main reason is there, if I start to lose track of where the edge of the weld is, dipping in and out sometimes helps me see a little bit better, plays the light a little bit better, helps me see exactly where the edge of the puddle is as opposed to where I need to be with it. Now, because I used a fairly large gap here, it's going to require a 2-bead cap. If I had chosen, say, a 332 gap, that would make it pretty easy to do a 1-bead cover pass, but I didn't, so it's going to take 2 beads. All right, now for the last bead, the second bead on a 2-bead cap, now I'm going to just be watching the top of that bead, trying not to leave any underfill or any undercut. So that means I'm going to, you know, keep a little pressure on the rod, not play the arc up too far, push a little rod in there when it needs it. And if I have to come in and out of the puddle and dip, I'll push enough rod in there toward the top of the puddle to make sure I don't leave any undercut at the top. I should call attention to the fact that I'm using a clear cup for arc shots and then a pink ceramic cup for the far away shots. It's two different coupons here. I'm trying to get as good an arc shot as I can in the clear cup. Really helps with that, and then the pink cup actually helps for the far away shots because it kind of blocks the arc everything doesn't get washed out. So I cut it right next to the weld so we could see if I got a decent root in there. I got a little reinforcement pushed through. Not my best work, but it's been a while. Well, good, you're still here. For the next minute or so, I'm going to show some clips of walking the cup from a previous video that I did, and I'll try to link that up. Those usually show up in the top right-hand corner if you're on YouTube. But I'll show a few clips of that. I'll show walking the cup versus freehand with a TIG finger. Here we go. Walking the cup is akin to rolling a 55-gallon drum across a shop floor. You sort of do a little figure eight, and it progresses you along at a nice even rate. It's a great technique. I'm using a piece of heavy wall stainless tubing here that I've scored some lines on, some little wagon tracks, just to sort of simulate the bevels of a pipe. It's a great technique, but you can't always do it. Sometimes stuff is in the way. And so sometimes it's good to have a TIG finger to prop right next to where you're welding, and you can handle the heat that way. And when you don't have to worry about your fingers roasting, you can hold your hand a lot steadier and concentrate on the weld. And by just doing a straight up Z-weave, you can get a weld that looks almost or equal to what you can get with walking the cup. Maybe not every time, but it's sure pretty darn close. Some jobs don't want you to walk the cup. Some jobs almost demand that you walk the cup. So it's great to know how to do both. These are my product, 100% made in the USA by friends and family. Thanks for watching. You can learn more at weldmonger.com.